Hi everyone, welcome to the show. This week my guest is Larry Carlson. Larry is a Brooklyn-based digital artist, and he's been developing his large body of work of video, music, and collage on his website, LarryCarlson.com, for the past 10 years. He had me over to his studio last week to talk about how things like psychedelics, cryptozoology, and the occult have influenced his work. Stay tuned. I'm here with Larry Carlson. Hi, Larry.
Hi, how's it going? If I was going to describe my work, I would say it's a huge body of many different things which all kind of interconnect. Mm-hmm. I do video art, and I do images, I do collages, but frequently I'll combine all of it, where in my video I'll have some of my collages, which are actual cut and paste, paper and glue, you know, paintings or whatever. And I'll use those in my digital work too. So I'm always into combining all the different forms. And I also make music, and the music is also the soundtracks for my videos. But behind it all, I would say there is a unifying collage process. And, you know, I was trained as a visual artist. I consider, you know, I was, even as a kid, I was always drawing and painting. And then I got into making soundtracks, and I feel like I was definitely, I'm coming at it from a visual sense where, mm-hmm, I almost see the samples in my mind, and I see the distortions and the layers of it the way I would if I was working on a collage or a photo or a painting. Mm-hmm. But behind it all, there is a sense of collage. I definitely think people can see that I'm highly influenced by psychedelics. You know, it's been a huge thing in my life, a major inspiration. I think, you know, I started using psychedelics and I started getting really into computers at the same time. Mm-hmm. And I think in my mind, it all sort of melted together where somehow I was able to use the computer to manifest what I was seeing in the strange parts of my mind that are only accessible sometimes, you know, during those very high moments. I love color. I think it's healing. I think it's like one of the most beautiful things that there is in life is just to enjoy the brilliance of pure color. So I love art that has a lot of great color in it. And I think that's why sometimes even in my movies or my interactive movies, there's a lot of flashing colors. It's almost because I just want to like pound it into people. And there's just like, it's almost like you're bathing in a rainbow.
Yeah, there's definitely, especially in the videos, there is almost like a physical reaction to it. Like I was looking at, they did a little spot about you on Vice, and I was looking through some of the feedback that people were leaving, and people would write stuff like, "It makes me uncomfortable, but good uncomfortable." One person wrote, "Every time I watch, I feel a little funny in my chest, and eventually I catch myself making these involuntary horrified faces, but I keep coming back to watch." That sort of physical reaction, yeah. I feel like is very common.
Yeah, I think a lot of that comes from the fact that as soon as I started putting my stuff online, I was getting that kind of feedback because that was my intention. I wanted to create maybe in the beginning a digital drug. Like when the internet kind of first hit in 99, 98, I was just starting a little bit. And I found the internet to be a very boring place. I thought it was corporate. I thought it was a lot of graphic designers. There wasn't anything cool on it, you know, like you actually find now more days. But it was definitely my intention was to sort of blow people away and to maybe create a sort of interactive digital drug that could blow your mind, especially under the right circumstances, you know. And for me, the computer most of the time is in a personal space, you know. It's in your home. A lot of times, especially if you're going to my site or if you're going to YouTube watching videos or something, a lot of times it's like at night, you know, and it's sort of a personal experience. And for me, that's really beautiful. It's actually kind of touching, you know, to be able to broadcast such wild stuff to people's homes. You know, mm-hmm. I just think I'm so happy to be alive at this moment in history because it's just amazing to me to have that ability now. And it really is at the heart of what I'm doing.
Drives me onward to feel all of the skin.
you mentioned that you were kind of interested in cryptozoology and some of that kind of stuff.
Definitely is a huge fascination of mine and also an inspiration for my work. And I actually do real research where I try to sometimes, you know, I study a map and I study reports and sightings, particularly around the Sasquatch phenomena. And I have done, you know, some research and staked out some places, you know, up in the mountains in Vermont and upstate New York. Just really intrigued by the wild man idea, you know, that there really could still be a group of people totally wild living right alongside our civilization. Mm-hmm. And we're not yet officially aware of it yet.
Right.
And
from the little bit that I've looked into it, it seems like there are a lot of reputable scientists who have been doing research. There's a lot of legitimate information and stuff out there about it, right?
Yeah, I mean, actually, when it comes to that, even Jane Goodall, the most famous anthropologist, definitely said that she believes that the evidence should be looked at, that there is evidence that there's something there. I mean, mm-hmm. just the footprints alone is what really got me into it when I started learning about the footprints, how it's almost impossible to fake, you know, that much data that's being found all the time. The actual dermal ridges on the footprints, which are kind of like, you know, dermal ridges are like fingerprints. Mm-hmm. It would be next to impossible to fake that. And those footprints are found all over the United States, all over Canada, even some in Mexico. That, I would say, is probably the most intriguing scientific evidence. Mm-hmm. The historical record, the footprints, and then I think the overwhelming amount of people who actually see it. There's a town up in New York that I pass through a lot, and I try to do a little bit of investigating up there, called Whitehall. And there's more sightings there than there are almost anywhere else in the East Coast.
Wow.
So many that even the police there have had several sightings. And even the chief of police has retired, and now he's a Bigfoot researcher.
Wow.
So I think situations like that, you know, are to me a lot of evidence, you know. Mm-hmm. But I do think the phenomena gets a little more weird than just that. Like, I do believe that maybe the reason that they've remained hidden so long, even as our civilization is expanding more and more into the wild places of America, is that they may have some sort of, you could call it shamanic power, or a spiritual power, or, you know, maybe some sort of animal instinct, mm-hmm. you know, some sort of telepathy. And even recently there has been evidence that there may actually be using a language. And that's what was recently, there was a new guy came out. He was a linguist. I guess he worked for like NATO and the CIA. He was a professional guy. Uh-huh. He didn't care at all about Bigfoot. Didn't care at all. He just heard about a story about someone taping the voices. So he listened and he was shocked because he heard language.
Wow.
And he studied the tapes and he actually proved that on the tapes, there is an actual language being spoken, you know. And that's more scientific evidence. One reason I'm so into it is because these are the boundaries between reality and unreality, or the fantastic, which I think my art is all about. It's like the fine line between waking up and dreaming. And there are some subjects like cryptozoology or the paranormal that I find myself attracted to and really into studying because they have that, where it's never really definable. It's always a mystery, mm-hmm. you know? And to me, that's what great art is in some ways. And I aspire to that in my work, is to add the element of mystery to it. So mm-hmm. it's always of undefinable sense.
And so he incarnates as none other than
a strange blend of God, man, and beast.
Thank you.
Who are some of the artists that that you're interested in?
I have a huge wide interest of art that I feel like informs my work. Anything from like ancient Egypt. I go on a lot of trips to Mexico, to the Yucatan Peninsula, where I do a lot of checking out a lot of pyramids and ruins, and even going to places that are a little bit hard to get to, where you have to just take a boat to get to. So I'm definitely highly influenced by Mayan culture now. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of that is showing up in my work. You know, I've been going now down there for the last like 10 years on and off.
What about the Mayan stuff is attractive to you?
Well, I think what I like is when you're actually there and you're just looking at it, uh-huh. and you see it carved into stone, it looks like the stuff that I see in my mind sometimes, you know? Like it insectoid or alien, I want to even say, even though I don't think it's alien, but
right.
I do think it's more like insectoid, or there's this burning heat, you know, there's this otherworldliness to it. That's what I find intriguing. I also find, you know, just the astrological alignments of some of the sites
right.
is a big pastime of mine, too. I'm very much into astrology and astroarchaeology, which is, you know, the study of sites that match up to the heavens.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the pyramids being the biggest example,
right.
but they're actually all over, including some stone chambers that are scattered around here from upstate New York all the way to New England, you know.
Did you play a lot of video games when, or do you still? Because I feel like looking at a lot of the videos and collages, there is sort of this kind of early video game 8-bit aesthetic.
I'm definitely into 8-bit, and yeah. I think recently it's manifested in my Twitter art and my Facebook update art, which is all sort of 8-bit work. I love Atari, you know, the original Atari stuff, yeah, is a big inspiration. The sounds, too.
Right.
I've sampled a lot of Atari sounds. I love it. I can't get enough of it.
Bye.
a lot of your work seems to reference the occult, and I know that's one of the, you know, an interest of yours. What sort of draws you to that, and how are you interested in incorporating it into your work?
The word occult, what does it mean? Secret knowledge, things that are hidden. There isn't much that's really hidden nowadays that you can't find on the internet, and that's what I'm trying to get at, is that for me, the real occult is what goes on in your mind, in the privacy of your mind, you know, how well you pay attention to your dreams, can you leave your body, where your attention is at, you know, and I'm very much into magic. I do practice my own form of magic. You know, I would call it a collage form of magic from many different sources. And for me, magic, it is an art form, the same way as making art. I don't really follow one particular religion or set of thought or philosophy. Like my art, it's sort of a hodgepodge, a collage of many different things. I'm very inspired by, you know, mysticism and mystical writing. I'm extremely inspired by, you know, Native American shamanism. I've lived most of my life in New York. When I was 17, I moved to the city to go to school at Cooper Union, and I pretty much have been here ever since, on and off. And in the off time, I pretty much lived out in the wild. I've lived a lot up in the mountains in Vermont. I've lived out in California, and I've traveled a lot around the country, almost in a Jack Kerouac way, you know, with no money, just hitchhiking half the time, sleeping on the side of the road. And it was definitely the biggest inspiration for me, but it was also magical, because I do find that when you do go away from people that think a certain way, then magic can happen.
Computer called the Soul Catcher.
It had windows in the side, yet it had an intensely bright spotlight that was scanning the ground. It had windows in the side.
Genetic engineering and new brainstorm. Digitizes your speech and her far-out phone lines can reach. With Interplanet, at phone home and not worry how about implanting a chip in your brain.
My tribes are traveling across the
lived a lot of different places. I've lived many different places in the United States. You know, like I was saying earlier, when I was younger, I definitely traveled around a lot, almost in a Jack Kerouac fashion. Places like Wyoming and Tennessee and California.
Uh-huh.
For a while, I actually, you know, worked in Sequoia National Park in California, up in the Sierra Nevada mountains, where I was able to spend a lot of time camping up there and whatnot. And I've definitely had the most wondrous experiences when I've been out in the wild, away from civilization. And, you know, that's why, for me, people I really admire are people like, you know, Thoreau and John Muir, you know, some of the naturalist guys from the beginning of the century. I would say one of the most wondrous things that ever happened to me was when I was out in the Sierra Nevadas. One day, you know, a buddy of mine said, hey, why don't we climb this mountain? It was one of the biggest mountains in the United States. So we started going up there. It took us about 2 days. And when I got to the top of the mountain, like, you know, we took a lot of acid, you know, a lot of really good LSD.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I had done a little bit here and there, but not ever that much.
Right.
And I think, you know, when I started seeing gods in the mountains.
Wow.
And the sky was full of just intergalactic beings, and my dreams and who I was and my and unconscious were all one. I don't think I ever really came down from that mountain. Like, it's weird, but I do feel like I received something up there that I've been, like, living off ever since.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just about getting high. It's about coming back,
right,
and going to my studio and filtering, right, it into my work.
Ralph, the time has come. The time has come to go out of your mind. Are you ready, Ralph? Are you ready to die and be reborn? No. No, first, you must be in a state of grace. First, you must examine yourself in this mirror of confession. What do you see there? Your personality. All your goals and your fears, your little ambitions. The chess game of your life. You have to check that, Ralph. You can't take that on a trip with you. And then that other side of you, Ralph, that dark unconscious, all those animal impulses which you hide and keep down below. All this baggage, too, must be checked. You can't take that on the billion-year voyage to God. Are you ready? Then take this chalice, the elixir of life, the ancient cup, the Holy Grail, the alchemist's stone of philosophy, the Holy Communion, the key to immortality. Take this and drink.
I'm just curious, could we just talk about LSD? Obviously, that's, like, a huge influence on your work. Like, are you interested in the darker sides of that sort of experience?
A very good question, yeah. Because I do feel very strongly about it, because I feel like the word psychedelic is a very loaded term. And I feel like a lot of people relate to the word psychedelic, like the Ken Casey and the image that Time Life presented, basically, of the quote-unquote hippies and the which I feel a lot of it was very manufactured and exaggerated in some way. And I actually don't identify with it. I do identify more with the real experience, with what just goes on in your own mind. And it's personal for each person. And I don't think it's really even cultural in some ways. I do think it causes cultural ripples, and probably always will and always has. But I don't really identify with the 60s at all. In some ways, I don't like the word psychedelic, you know, because it has this, like, meaning of the 60s, quote-unquote, which to me, like, what does that even mean? I feel like half of it's just a manufactured thing, when I feel like what really goes on when you take stuff like that, when you really do it, it's something in your mind that's spiritual, that goes beyond time and space and culture. And you know, I would also say that maybe I do identify a little bit more with the dark side, because my experiences haven't been all rainbows and colors. Some of them have, but I've also been in spooky dimensions, talking to ghosts, you know. Be careful to never get evil, because I don't feel like I am evil, and I try to stay away from evil.
Right.
But I do feel like there is a spooky dimension, like a sort of mysterious place where things are real and unreal, and maybe you actually get a chill down your spine.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that I aspire to in my work. And, you know, I have had some bad trips too, I guess you could call them that, but they've also inspired my work, and I hope people can even see that in the work, is that it isn't all like roses and rainbows, you know, that it's both. It's just like the human experience. It's good and bad, light and darkness, day and night. You know, there's an infinite variety of life, and I feel like psychedelics are the same way. And I feel like that's even what's happening now. I feel like maybe I'm a little bit of a pioneer of it, but they're starting to merge with cyber and with digital, where there's definitely a new, even I feel like more powerful thing going on now than was going on in the 60s. It's just the mass media doesn't focus on it or talk about it or label it as a movement.
It's twilight now in New York.
Today being dissolved.
Ah.
Spacecrafts are powered by mind power, and frequency is the fuel. She has learned that there is no time. Time is silent. I am a strange loop. She had the ancient secrets of levitation. She has black magic 18. Focus, focus. People are receiving symbols in their heads. She wears a dress made of water, conscious of the invisible helping hand.
It's twilight now in New York.
Strange thing flying about could very well be a snally history. 13 Electrographic X by the Angel Moromi. Advent ventures into weird worlds and then quickly disappears. The agents of divine will in our day-to-day being dissolved. She has learned that the invisible helping hand in you and surround you. Because that strange thing flying about could very well be a smiley visitor.
It's twilight now in New York.
I really love New York. I mean, I definitely consider myself a New Yorker, even though I grew up in Jersey, but I just grew up, you know, basically a couple miles over. An interesting job I used to have a long time ago in New York was I was a bike messenger. I was like just in the city, in the street, you know, fighting cab drivers left and right, you know.
Yeah.
Biking in New York is unlike biking in other places because it's a constant game of attention. You have to be aware if a door is going to open on you, because, or if a cab's going to pull in front of you, or if a bus is going to pull in front of you. It's a constant, almost zen state of hyper alertness to survive. And then what happens is the more you do it, you start to go into a zone, and it becomes unconscious, but you also become one with the city. And it's very much like Tron in some ways, where you're in this like circuit board, you know.
Right.
I love it. I mean, it's actually one of my favorite hobbies is biking in New York, you know.
Thanks so much for doing the show and for being so open and sharing so much with us. It was, I really appreciate it.
I really appreciate the opportunity to get some of my thoughts out. I would just say to people, you know, everyone has a computer, just go check out my website, LarryCarlson.com, and from there you can see all the various art projects that I've, web projects that I've been working on the last couple of years. You know, it's all cataloged. And I'm also, like I said, I'm very prolific, where I'm always publishing new stuff. Usually as soon as I make a new image, I like to get it online quickly just to give it to people and to get feedback. So it's exciting. If you're interested, check out my stuff, because there's always something new and there's a lot of stuff in the archives. So please just check out my work and enjoy it.
That's our show for this week. Thanks for listening. Thanks to Larry Carlson for sitting down to talk with me. And be sure to check out his website, LarryCarlson.com. You're listening to Art Uncovered on BreakThru Radio.